thanks to the DAR and the CAR at 15-year-old Chantry, fresh off his stage debut in Our Town at Red Carpet Community Theater, got an ask if we wanted to come and give tours at the Good Home House at the State Fair, and I still had my newsboy costume in hand, so we said absolutely, and I gave tours of the son's bedroom. So it's a thrill to be speaking. And listen, I do, you know what? I do act most of the time like I know what I'm talking about. That's where the MFA comes in handy. So I just want to start by saying I met June Chubbuck March of 2020. I was a month into the job at Preservation Oklahoma as executive director, and this woman accosted me and said, please come down to the Edwards store. We're doing great work. We've just received a grant from the Oklahoma Historical Society, a heritage grant, and I'd love to meet you and love for you to see this property. As a Western Oklahoma kid, Southeast Oklahoma was a foreign land to me, and the further off I got from the highway, the scarier it all became. And then cell phone service dropped out, and then looking for the property, I drove by it two or three times before I actually found it, and there was June, a life force, a force to be reckoned with, and the reason, one of the main reasons that the Edwards store is in the place it is today. She has taken me under her wing. We've been fast friends ever since, and one of my favorite collaborators in the entire state of Oklahoma. And what she and her team have done at the Edwards store, I think, as an advocate for historic preservation, should and could be a model of private and nonprofit partnerships that everyone should take the opportunity to do. So, thank you. You're welcome.
You are so kind. And if you don't learn anything else the rest of the day, join Preservation Oklahoma. If you have a project, start with Preservation Oklahoma and really consider the grant program that Nicole administers. We would not be where we are today, and we'll show you kind of how we got there, but we wouldn't be there today if it were not for the partnership with those two. And if you have a place on the National Register already, talk to Matt. If you have a place that you think is National Register eligible, talk to Matt. Shippo is full of information. So, okay, I'm finished. Yeah. That's really what we wanted you to know today.
Yeah, and the great news is there's no reason to ever do it alone. Right, we're all here to do this together and preserve these wonderful spots across the state. So,
how many of you all are here because you have a historic place?
I've seen one or two. Yes.
In Southeast Oklahoma. Yes.
Thank you.
There's so much history in Southeast Oklahoma. Yeah, but that's a whole other story. Our project was on the National Register, listed in 1972. Primarily because of its meal stop position on the Butterfield Overland Mail Route. The other thing we did in 2021, we sort of re-upped our National Register listing. So that's a possibility also. We expanded the scope of the listing to include the cemetery and encompass the homestead. The cabin itself is the homestead cabin. It was listed as the Edwards store. It's not the store cabin. The store cabin is no longer extant. But so we also wanted to clarify that going forward, that what we are trying to restore is the actual homestead cabin. But then we kept all the history of why it was listed in the first place and incorporated a little more of the story of pre-statehood commercial life.
Yeah, and I think that determining, number one, is your property eligible for the National Register of Historic Places is really a wonderful place to start in regards to this process. So.
And then the next thing is, what kind of shape your property is in? Is it an endangered property? We had an endangered property. It was about to fall down. And so we approached the folks at Preservation Oklahoma and submitted a nomination to be listed on their most endangered places list. And we were successful in doing so. We were listed in 2018 and 2019. And Chantry is the person that whose organization handles the endangered list. And each year they publish an endangered list and generate a mechanism for creating publicity around your endangered property. And that begins to bring awareness. And having people be aware of your place is a very important aspect of what you will be trying to do, not only as restoration begins, but going forward in sustaining and maintaining the property. Awareness is key.
Yeah, the most endangered places list is Preservation Oklahoma's, I would say, flagship programming that we do for the year. The list will come out in July of this year, and it is also celebrating its 30th year of existence. Our first list was in 1993, and we're now entering right? Is that 30? That is 30 years. And so while being listed on the most endangered places list does not guarantee anything for your site or your property, it does help in fundraising efforts. It does help in grant writing efforts. And it does help where we really can be successful together as being an advocate and the PR team for your endangered site.
And this is just a couple of quick slides of our endangered places listing. And the first thing we did is we took the statewide exhibit panel you see there in the lower right, and we took it to Wilburton, the county seat of Latimer County. And people walked through and said, we didn't know there was such a place. And it's just 20 miles down the road. So this is a little bit about who Thomas and Nancy Edwards are. Thomas was an Englishman, immigrated to Indian Territory around 1847, met and married Nancy Hardaway from a prominent Choctaw family, and they established their homestead on the Fort Smith Boggy Depot Road, which was a major Chickasaw removal road when the Chickasaw tribe was moved into the Choctaw Nation. They use the Fort Smith Boggy Depot Road. The property is owned by the family still. We now have seventh and eighth generations of the family. This is our sixth generation descendant. She is the executive director of our nonprofit that we created in 2019.
The next important step, I do think, if you have established a good relationship with the property owner, or you are the property owner, establishing a 501c3, a nonprofit organization, is the next great step in securing funding, securing publicity for your organization. June just helped the family and advocates for Star House, Quanah Parker Star House down in Cache, Oklahoma, establish finally, after years of trying, a 501c3 for Quanah Parker Star House. We love the Edwards store, but Quanah Parker Star House is fresh on everyone's mind all day, every day, it seems like. I get more calls and questions about Star House than any other property in the state of Oklahoma. And I know, Shippo, you probably all get quite a few questions about Star House as well. So, June, if you would just talk to us about the process of establishing. It's not a difficult process. Correct, of establishing a 501c3.
No, it's not difficult, and the IRS gives you line-by-line instructions on how to do it. Lots of lines and lots of instructions, but it is doable. And you submit your application and declare yourself to be a charitable, acting entity, and teaching people, educating people, restoring property, those are considered charitable activities. And so you demonstrate that that's what you do, and then the Internal Revenue Service will examine those statements and who you have on your board and what your purposes are. First thing you need to do is become incorporated in, and I assume this is everybody, Oklahoma. Become a not-for-profit organization in Oklahoma. It costs you $25
to register with the Secretary of State.
With the Secretary of State. And then with those papers in hand, you submit those and your application to the Internal Revenue Service. And then you will be determined to be a tax-exempt organization such that your donors are permitted to deduct their donations to your organization from their personal income taxes.
And so how was it, if you could tell us what it was like establishing the 501c3 for the Edwards store with family members still, with family members surviving and part of the process?
Yes, and you need to be careful when you structure your board. You can't have too many family members on your board. We have a policy every time we add a board member and it has a family connection, then we add one or two more non-family members to the board. We only have five now, but we're still in balance as far as the IRS is concerned. And we didn't even know who our owners were when we got started. Went to the courthouse, found out who I thought the owners were, and not all the records are online. Sometimes you have to go back and really pull the old books off the shelf, which is really fun and what I like to do. But I reached out on Facebook, and that's how I found one of the owners of the property. And I sent a message to her, and I said, "Are you by any chance the same Chrissy Dickmeyer that is associated with the Edwards store in Oklahoma?" And she texted me back and said, "Yes, who are you?"
And Chrissy lives where? Remind us where Chrissy lives.
Chrissy lives in North Carolina. And so anyway, we met over Facebook, we talked on the phone, and we ultimately had an organizational meeting where we established our 501c3.
And she was open to the prospect from the get-go, right?
It was her father's desire. And as a kid growing up, she went to the cabin often and helped him, he's since passed, helped him do work around the cabin and learned the stories of the cabin at his knee and her grandmother's knee. And she's all about this. And we were really honored to have the opportunity to work with her and her family.
Yeah, so the bummer of the whole situation would be if Chrissy had said, "We're not interested. We have no desire to form a 501c3, or we don't want any public or private help with this. It's our property." It ends there, basically. So don't push it, and don't go behind any owners' backs to create a 501c3 without their permission. It's the same as creating a National Register nomination. You only want to go forward with the property's owner's permission.
And we partnered with the Oklahoma Historical Society through SHPO and through the grant program, and we received an award in 2022 for the upgrade to our National Register listing, which was shepherded in all sorts of ways by Matt Pierce, who's here today. Matt, thank you for all you did.
Can y'all explain what is SHPO?
Oh, of course.
Yeah, okay.
Sure. If you're unaware of SHPO, sorry, it is the Oklahoma State Historic Preservation Office. They handle the state's National Register's listings, Section 106, the historic tax credit projects that happened in our state. And what else am I missing?
This is your show.
I'm not SHPO, but you know what? They are the most important people that you will deal with, I think, on a state level. If you have more questions, feel free to ask at the SHPO table after our presentation. Thank you.
All right, and I will follow that with the model is here today. In doing the historic research, Chrissy and I came across an old newspaper article that talked about a model of the Edwards store. And we're like, oh, wow, how cool. Let's see if we can find that model. So I was up in Stillwater, we tracked it out, it traveled around the state, and they had all these special cases built for it. And we went around and we tried to contact all the people that were at these. This was in 1983. And so not very many people that were part of the original traveling show were even around. And we're like, oh no, what are we gonna do? So I finally reached out to SHPO, and I get an email back from Linda Ozen that says, June, you know she should always start and ask SHPO first. They have it. They have the entire 7-model display in the SHPO office. It was an absolute thrill to locate it. But yeah, go to SHPO.
Yeah.
And we were able to use this model and had an exhibition. We were able to get grant money from Oklahoma Humanities to do an exhibit. And so during the fall festival in Latimer County down at Robbers Cave, we had a special exhibit of the log cabin model, which was a lot of fun.
Another step in this grand process of preservation, I think, is determining where the property sits in the world of local history, regional history, state history, and then national history. Looking here at the map, we can see that the Edwards store, that its DNA is part of Oklahoma history, starting with the Louisiana Purchase up to the Indian removals, all the way up to post-Civil War Reconstruction. And then, of course, the Butterfield Trail as well, which we will get to. So where does your property sit in regards, and not everything needs to be of national significance, right? Local significance, local history is just as important to me as a preservationist as any sort of national significance. So where I don't care if it's not significant at all, that's a joke. Everything's significant in some capacity. But we will help you. I would be happy to help you determine where your property, where your site fits into the greater picture of history in the United States and Oklahoma. So, you know, Oklahoma was and is the center of commerce for the United States, and as westward expansion happened as well. In 1858, Butterfield Overland Mail begins its first transcontinental mail and passenger service, reaching St. Louis to San Francisco. And then, of course, the Mother Road, as we approach the centennial of Route 66, Route 66 from Chicago to Santa Monica, more miles, which we will always remind you, more miles in this state than any other state along Route 66. And then, of course, in 1956, the establishment of the interstate highway system from Wilmington to Barstow, Interstate 40, highest continuous end-to-end traffic of any interstate. And you know, if you get on I-40 to go east or west, you're on it until you're not. I mean, it's a never-ending interstate highway. And so we have been the center of traffic and of commerce from the very beginning. I mean, this, of course, we predate even that with the Texas Road and things like that. But here's a map of the Butterfield Overland Mail Route, and jump in anytime you want to
I love the quote from Ormsby. I'm sure it was absolutely positively true. Butterfield was given 25 days to deliver the mail from St. Louis and Memphis to San Francisco. It had to be under 25 days or less per contract. Before that, and these are the things I didn't know, and the stuff I have learned about history since I started on this project is just wonderful. But before that, it took 3 to 4 months by the mail to travel by packet from the boat down through the Isthmus of Panama, and then around and up to San Francisco. So the overland mail which went right through the heart of Indian Territory, was absolutely an essential piece of the continental movement west. And the fun thing that I like to think about this is the Fort Smith was key because the mailbag from Memphis and the mailbag from St. Louis merged in Fort Smith and then immediately went across the river into Indian Territory. So that's just another little snippet of how important Oklahoma's history is to our nation's commerce.
And if you're familiar with the southeast part of the state, you know it's not an easy terrain to cross, especially on a stage there. So here's a map then of the area we concentrate on in regards to the Butterfield. And so here's Edwards' store. This is kind of at an angle, right? Yeah, so north is there. Here's where we are. Here's the Edwards store, an unofficial stop on the Butterfield Overland Mail Route, not too far away from Holloway's station and Riddle's station. Both of those were those official stops?
Those were both official. There were 12 official stops. When the National Register listing was done for the Edwards store in conjunction with the other 12 stops, it was identified as the 13th, the Baker's Dozen. And the store is at sort of this northward end of the Narrows through the Sanboy Mountains. So getting from the Edwards store to the Holloway Station, which was only about 4 miles, was a significant increase in elevation. So they would breathe the mules at the Edwards store while the passengers bought their meals. And then they would change mule teams when they got onto the Holloway, just down the road. And then Riddle's is kind of right at the edge of Wilburton, if that helps you put that in mind.
Yeah, so here's Red Oak, and then here's Wilburton, just to give you an idea, which basically, so the trail kind of follows, basically where 270 is today.
Yeah. Okay, so we decide we're going to restore this cabin out in the middle of nowhere. And
why did you decide that? So that's another great question asked too. Why do we feel the need that this building is worthy of preservation and restoration?
Because it is absolutely encapsulates Oklahoma's history. It is a story from the Louisiana Purchase until the last occupant, which was 1981, was the last time the family resided there. So it covers the Louisiana Purchase to the modern day, and it is still standing. And you don't see that much anymore. We have an 1850 log cabin that is still standing.
Right, and I think so, looking to being able to switch from the emotional plea when asking for funds or asking for help, talking about how this building is woven into Oklahoma history. And then to just the logical side, too, it's like, hey, it's the only extant building on the Butterfield left in Oklahoma. That appeals to some, either a left or a right brain, I'm not sure, but it appeals to some people, and the emotional plea appeals to other people as well.
Okay, so we started first with a preliminary assessment in 2018. First of all,
always start here, please. POK, always start with an assessment, please.
The is it restorable? Not everything should or can be saved. So that was the first question. Is it restorable? And the gentleman you'll see there in the photograph is Bill Bailey. He is our log cabin consultant. He has done a lot of work on log cabins in Oklahoma, the Kerr Boyhood Cabin down in Ada. He did some work in the Fort Gibson area. He's built a keelboat, by the way. This is the kind of guy he is. He's a master artisan and craftsman. And he built a keelboat, which is now going to be on exhibit at Fort Gibson because I think it belongs there because that's where the Three Rivers are and all that good stuff. So anyway, that's Bill, and he's a wonderful walking, talking historian. And then we improved the site security. After Bill's assessment, he said these chimneys are going to fall down if you're not careful, and people are going to start carrying all the stones away. So we made application the inaugural year of the Heritage Preservation Grant Program to stabilize the chimneys. And we were successful, we were awarded, and we are eternally grateful because the chimneys would have collapsed. You see the photograph of the stone wedged in. That stone had fallen down inside the chimney flue, was lodged in the flue. Bill, I don't have a picture of it, I wish I did, but out of the back of his truck, he rigs up a baling wire and board contraption of some sort and actually fished this stone out of the flue and put it back in place. So we were able to save the chimneys from imminent collapse.
And this is where I came into the picture for the first time. I was there on one of those days. So,
and we knew we had made it because you know that song about you on the cover of Rolling Stone. We made the cover of Preservation Oklahoma News.
My first issue, so I was struggling. Just kidding, June. It was happy to put it on on the cover. And like I said, that's where POK helps out a lot. You know, we do have a widely read quarterly newsletter that we do publish in conjunction with the State Historic Preservation, in collaboration with the SHPO office, and people read it. I'm glad to know people read it, people spend time with it, and so getting your property on our most endangered places list, or you do have some preservation success with your property, I'm happy to feature it because I'm always thirsty for content. So
the next phase was then the historic architecture documentation. We wanted to record what we had, and God forbid if we should someday not have it. And so we, with funding from the Heritage Preservation Grant Program, we were able to do the historic architecture documentation. They measured everything, they photographed everything, they made notes in the field, numbered everything, and we have in preparation a submission to the National Park Service for the Library of Congress Historic Buildings Survey Collection. Part of what we did in the documenting and the conditions assessment that was done in 2021 was we actually used LIDAR scanning. And now you know all I know about LIDAR scanning. But the million points of light are reflected in the scans of this cabin. And we can see the areas of rot and the areas of deterioration. And we have a complete exact record of the condition of the cabin. Using all the computer digital things, they then are reduced to line drawings that will become part of the collection in the Library of Congress. And those are just some of the preliminary architectural work. Then we did some physical interventions. Those of you that were here earlier, perhaps for Nicole's presentation, the grant program won't fund absolutely everything. We had to be responsible for some of the stuff, and that was the physical interventions. We tore the porches off the cabin, and I sat in the car and cried, but it had to be done. Bill Bailey said they're gonna skew the wall logs, they'll torque, and the walls will come falling down. So we took them off, we covered the roof, and we have now buttoned up the cabin. As you can see in that upper corner picture, it's buttoned up and ready now for restoration.
You know, I can't remember if it's on the slideshow or not, apologies, but when you are responsible, when we are responsible for non-grant funded projects, fundraising activities are great for your organization. the Adopt a Chimney Stone project was a great success for Edwards' store, right? I think almost all of them have been.
We still have some available.
Oh, yeah, please.
Should you choose to adopt a stone, you may do so. Just give me a call. There's not any maintenance required or anything, but that worked out really well. Yeah. Thank you for that,
you bet.
Chantry.
And then, you know, get your community involved as well. Students from nearby Red Oak came out, and they're, you know, child labor is my favorite sort of labor, free. use your local groups for help. I don't mean that. I keep forgetting this is recorded for posterity. I'm saying terrible things. The volunteers are there. Just activating and keeping your volunteers engaged is of the utmost importance.
And the students were absolutely wonderful. They went to the cemetery, and you'll see in the photograph, that is Thomas Edwards and Nancy Edwards' resting place. It's a stone cairn, and there are lots of rocks on top. Well, the students wanted to know, why are there rocks on top of this? And so I was able to share with them some of the culture and traditions of a number of peoples that place stones on their ancestors' grave. And that's what's happening here. So that was a really cool thing that I got to do. And when Bill Bailey has the chance to talk to the students, that's one of the things that he loves to do most. So whatever you do, incorporate the younger generation into these projects and allow them to learn. They're like sponges. The young man in the upper, upper right, I don't know if you have seen from the other photos, the dog-trot, which is kind of the breezeway part of the cabin, has a hidey hole. And so Ruger sticks his head down in the hidey hole, and his cell phone is down in the hidey hole. He's got his flashlight on, and he says, "I found a shoe! I found a shoe!" And so everyone comes running so we can get this artifact. And it just turned out to be a rubber, non-consequential shoe. But anyway, we had a great time doing that. We had budding archaeologists that day. And then, again, through the help of the Heritage Preservation Program grant, we were able to do an archaeological survey, which we just completed the first part of that this last March, and found all kinds of stuff. And we think we have located where the original store sat. And they found it had become a blacksmith shop after the store closed when the railroad bypassed the store. But because of the iron that was found in and around this location where we sort of thought it might be, we think we've now pinpointed the exact location of the store.
Oh, here we go. Yes. So,
yeah.
Like I said, fundraising is such an important aspect of your nonprofit's organization. And when the grant funds run out or can't cover what you need them to cover, asking people for money is the way to go. And people are willing and able to give for the right thing with the right ask. The Adopt a Chimney, I think, is a really terrific and easy fundraising activity that, you know what, have you got stacked stones somewhere on your property? Adopt those bricks, adopt those stones one by one for what is this, 25?
$35.
A cookbook published by the Edwards store, you know, new copies of that being sold. And I do think it is a great way to supplement grant funds raising funds for things that your grants don't always cover. So.
Fundraising will be an absolute ongoing forever task. Unless you have someone who's just absolutely loaded with millions and millions and millions and dedicates them to you.
Yeah. Which then means that your project will not be done in a year's time, which means that one aspect of your project could be done in 2 or 3 years' time. What do you think, and then of course here, just how to follow the Edwards store, how to keep up to date, but how do you, what's the anticipated completion time for the Edwards store?
We're now looking at 2027, but I think looking at that realistically, that may be optimistic. We have our architects tell us that it's not unusual for these projects to take 10 to 15 years. So 2027, 2028 is pushing 10. It will probably take longer than that.
Yeah. So, and with the national trail designation now for the Butterfield, I think will be very beneficial for the Edwards store. Of course it will be very beneficial. I think that's everything, right?
I think that's everything.
We have a few minutes. Any questions about what June's doing or what we do?